four, one, two, three, four, five, six.
Difference is a thing that makes us all individuals. Six, seven, eight, one, the thing that stops us from being clones.
One, two, three, four, five, six,
but now, one, our differences are being put into categories. We are being labelled. Even though we talk different, walk different, express ourselves differently, but because we walk together, talk together, do we express ourselves as one? You're so busy trying to create a colourblind world, you can't see that we're all being defined by stereotypes. We are living in a world where being unique is weird. By deciding to go against the rules of society, we are deemed not normal. But please, someone tell me, what is normal?
From all the things that people tell me about my personality, I have so much inspiration to write about it. The friends that I have now, my true friends, are the ones that love me the way I am. And they accept the way I am. And I accept who they are as well. I am so grateful I have those friends because I know I can be a right bitch on some occasions. I love being in the fucking center of attention. I think my life is going to be really hectic in the future. I'm determined for it to be hectic and busy in the future because I want my big wild dreams to come true. I really do, and I hope they do. If that sounds egotistical, to be honest, I've gone to the point in my life where I don't care what people think about me at all. I like the fact that I'm surrounded by artistic people like myself. Ever since I went to Brave New Voices, International Poetry Slam Festival, I discovered myself more as an artist. I don't know what I would do without poetry being in my life. It's an emotional outlet for me. It's something that was there for me when I had nothing else. It's something that has affected me a lot in my life, not coming out to my mother. It just had such an impact on me as a person and as an artist. What I've gone through has made me stronger. There's only one Jamal Gerald.
Dear Mother, remember there was never a father figure in existence. My heart is bruised. Filter the color of love I have for men into fire and burn my speechless depression. It hurts to see you bob your head to those dancehall tracks like Boom Bye Bye, whilst Elephant Man sizzler and boo jubai and threatens the lives of the people like your son. It hurts to know people like you could get pleasure out of seeing a male body like a collapsing rainbow. Brutally beaten by homophobic thorns, resembling the crown Jesus wore until this thing you call an abomination is out of him. Leviticus says, if a man lies with a man as one lies with the woman, they both have done what is detestable. They must be put to death, their blood will be on their heads. I began engaging in sexual acts with females, trying to convince myself that I'm still walking in a straight line, that it's just a phase, that God still loves me. Dear Mother, answer me this. Why would I choose to be a sin? Why would I choose to have my mother look down in shame? Why would I choose when God knitted me in your womb as I am? I need muscle, which defends me from the undesired kiss from the shivery winds. Someone holding me and keeping me warm is what I crave. Born to find woman's curves uninviting, hourglass and voluptuous features just don't do it for me. I'm sorry. I won't be bringing home your future daughter-in-law for our family Sunday dinner. Now, you have the answer to your question. Why don't you have a girlfriend? You shouldn't be so shocked. You did say the words. If you are, don't tell me. when I was young. You chained me from my wrist to your wrist. You never used to let me play out. I stayed in my room, imagining how to shoot hoops with my wrists, relaxing with the grace of femininity, which tickled my poetic fingertips and made me realize I was born to write this poem and that I was born this. Yours sincerely. Your sin.
I don't think I'm particularly outgoing. I'd see myself as introverted. I have absolutely no problem spending the day on my own. I would far rather go into a room and sit down in the corner and listen to the people and what they have to say and what they seem to need to say to everyone all the time. I've been brought up to try as much as possible to give yourself that extra second before you say anything at all. And in that extra second, you sort of, I certainly do most of the time, just realise that it's not worth saying and it's of no importance or consequence. I do come across, therefore, often as very quiet. So much more goes on inside than comes out. I have lots of dreams. I'd like to do lots of things. I'd like to accomplish lots of things. I don't necessarily aspire greatly to doing them, though. Like, this is an excuse as well as something I definitely believe, and it's the same with my poetry. It takes as long as it does, and again, that sort of sounds like I lack motivation. I got asked the other day, would you write as a job? And I thought, well, actually, I'm not sure if I would, because I'd rather have it as a healing process that I see it as. Because I feel that when I write poetry, it's a sort of outlet and an escape and something that's not sort of constructed.
I pace a space of limited freedom, a space where, when love's concerned, we're rarely in our right mind. And time's eternal lines wash out onto white pages in elegant contours of black, outlining all it is I cannot say, like ink on a body bathed in caramel. Tonight the roof is open, and enigmatic shapes fill the void above our heads. Incandescent shapes, swirling and burning at night before the eyes of stars, the stern staring, bright shafts of winking white and yellow and crystal. O Pompeian girl, the old me was young. O reckless indecision, ever evading good sense, like shapes in the black, light evasive figures of light lost spaces, pining at hope in the dark. O discontented winter of your youth, you have been weighed, you have been found wanting, you're going down, and I am coming with you. Electricity hurts, the hippie code is broken. Placid indifference envelops my heart. The city reeks of urban folk, miscalculation and conceit. I eat my hand, fingers first, contemplating the epic cycle, like Plato in the shadow of the Buell Gate, and write drivel with the narcotic mind of a sonneteer. Past cure I am, now reason is past care. Still, no star-fangled shape of blurry mind's eye reveals itself. Still, the work is not yet done, tilting for months on end upon the abyss of some nauseating, overheated, drug-induced calm before the storm. I lose my touch and touch loose ends of quasi-philosophical moments of enlightenment, of repulsion, of some other nonsensical, unimportant bullshit like the etymology of God and good. Good God and giddy aunts, and aunties that would put the sophists and the pop world and the upper class and parliamentary embarrassments and the football score and grammar and self-induced debt and man flu and off days and awkward dates and broken phones and insufferable library fellows and hangovers and the middle class and the first world problems and second world problems and no signal and problems with the ex and the wrong coloured flowers and the fickle whims of fussy eaters, the repulsion of grown men at the sight of blood or a reasonably dirty kitchen surface. surface. A broken string, a bad day, a long week, a bad long week, a weekend cut short, a shortchanging, the wrong size internet delivery, the trivial pursuit of ancient notions of justice, the early mornings and morning sickness, and the evasive nature of soulmates and talent and happiness, myxomatosis, dissertation proposals and dissertations, and deadlines and paychecks and checkups, anything that is not fighting for your life or for those you love. Aunties that put all of this to shame. She is strong. She eats Odysseus for breakfast with his affable, sneering, divine assistance. Lighten her load if you can. My helpless heart and I are here all week, and my velvet tongue will inflame and be an irritant. My unconscious will tell me that you scoff, though you don't. I know you don't. Yet doubt and delusion will prevail, and I find myself pacing a space of limited freedom, crowded by celestial forms, looming deadlines, and unfinished sentences.